In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. My beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, what is it about this great feast of the paramounts of the apostles, Peter and Paul, that gives it such glory? Why is it that this feast is so important to the life of the church that after the feast of Pentecost, we fast up until this feast? Why is it relaxed on this day? Is it because Peter and Paul are two of the greatest saints of the church? Most assuredly. But there are many saints of the church who lived during their times and had such epithets as the great or equal to the apostles. So what is it about Peter and Paul that makes them so unique to the church? It's precisely that word, church, that is significant in both of them. Throughout St. Paul's letter that you heard read this morning, he says that he boasts of his weakness, that it is not his strength that he wishes to boast of, but his weakness. For all the things that he mentioned, the shipwrecks, the stonings, the 40 lashes minus one that he endured, all these things were only possible through the grace of God. Even when he speaks about his miraculous vision in which he was brought to the third heaven, he says he does not brag. He does this to show us that the glory of the church is not found in strength of power, rather in humility and weakness. That when we allow ourselves to humble ourselves and let the will of God go forward, then true leadership, true power happen. But when we try to wrangle something or control it, it loses its luster. It loses its beauty. The second thing we learn about the church is found in the Matins Gospel. We look at St. Peter. For St. Peter, after denying Christ three times, is brought back into the church. Because Jesus Christ three times asks him a very simple question. Do you love me? And three times Peter answers the same way. I love you. But in Greek, it could not be more different. For the way that Peter answers Christ is not the way Christ asked the question. Christ asked the question in Greek, agapasme. Do you have selfless love? The kind of selfless love that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ had for us when he ascended the cross to die for us. Peter, who had denied Christ, could not honestly say, I have selfless love. And so he responded with philo, friendly love, affectionate love, not of the same caliber, not of the same level. And then Jesus Christ doesn't miss a beat. He says, tend my sheep. He asks this question a second time. Feed my lambs, after Peter again says, I love you, but with affectionate love. But then Jesus Christ does something that is unique. Devastating for Peter, but great for us. He asks Peter, feliz me. Do you at least have affectionate love for me? Peter was sad because Jesus Christ said it that third time. He was not sad because Christ asked him three times, do you love me? Peter was astute enough to understand he was being redeemed for his three denials. He was grieved because Jesus Christ lowered the bar for him. He made it more accessible. Say, that's okay. I get that you're not up here. You don't have agape yet. But you have philo. We'll get you there. The way that it is done is by taking care of the church shepherd. Feed the lambs. Tend the sheep. And of course, Peter does this. It is through St. Peter that we receive the first Gentile convert in Cornelius. It is through Peter who is, as Christ says, is the rock of the church, that we have the first Council of Jerusalem. It is through Peter that we see what our declaration should be on who is Jesus Christ. You are the Christ, Son of God. When Jesus Christ in today's gospel passage asked the people, who do they say that I am? The Son of Man. This is a prophetic being, the Son of Man. It is also Jesus Christ showing his humanity, that he associates himself with us. Jesus Christ is humble. He does not call himself the Christ, not call himself God, in this case. He's looking for us, sir. And Peter did. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter is told, it was not flesh and blood. It was not your intellect that revealed this to you, Peter, but my Father who is in heaven. And so Peter, this broken vessel, this person who denied Christ, Jesus Christ knows all things. He knew that Peter would deny. He still says of him, I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and hell will not prevail over the church. Of course, the devil tries to prevail over the church. So I invite you to look at the icon of this feast, of Saints Peter and Paul. This icon is usually displayed in one of two ways. In one way, they're each holding the church. As we said, represent the church. Leadership, the rock of the church. And the apostle to the Gentiles, St. Paul. But in the more appropriate view, see the two men embracing one another, hugging one another. Why is this? Because St. Peter, though he is the rock of the church, he fell into. There was a contingent of Jews during the time of the early Christian church that were saying that in order for you to be a Christian, first you must be circumcised. First you must become a Jew. St. Paul said, no. It's only through baptism that you need enter the church, only through the declaration of your faith. So there was an argument, there was a problem in the church. And so, they brought this problem to the church in Jerusalem, and all of the fathers of the church came together, discussed this, and then Peter, as we see in the Acts of the Apostles, comes out and declares, this is the church, that we will not put stumbling blocks in the ways of people entering into the church. This is important for today for two reasons. One, it shows us that we are not to put blocks people's way. Entering the church is not supposed to be something that is so arduous and difficult that no one can do it. We're supposed to find ways, like good fishermen, cast our nets out and bring people in, just as Peter is a fisherman. More than this, it shows us how we handle disagreements in the church. We come all together, we discuss it, we let the Holy Spirit enlighten us, and then proclaim truth. This is how the seven ecumenical councils were convened. This is how this first council, is not one of the seven, was convened in Jerusalem. But more important, vastly more important, and what is critical for our souls, because not all of us are bishops, not all of us are theologians, but all of us have had arguments with people. All of us have had disagreements with people. Sometimes we're proven. Sometimes we're not correct. Look at this icon as Peter and Paul embrace one another, loving one another, forgiving one another. This is the icon, this great feast we should take. Not just the history of these two amazing saints among saints, the highest, the paramounts of the apostles, Peter and Paul, how they come together and how they humble themselves, how they embrace one another. Let us have that same measure of humility and love for our brothers and sisters when we have arguments. We have disagreements. Come together. Let's talk. And then, when it's done, let us not be haughty or angry that we lost our argument. Let us embrace one another. Let us hug one another. Let us look for truth. Is Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. In the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit.
Let us sing.